Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Astronaut Maker, How One Mysterious Engineer Ran Human Spaceflight for a Generation, by Michael Cassutt, narrated by Eric Martin. The real book about the manned space program would be a book about George Abbey. Richard H. Truly, two-time shuttle flyer, former NASA administrator, 1989 to 1992. Prologue. On November 11, 1982, the crew of STS-5, the first operational flight of the Space Transportation System, or Space Shuttle, emerged from the crew quarters at the Kennedy Space Center, headed for Launch Pad 39A. Trailing the four astronauts in their blue flight gear was a dark-haired, middle-aged man in a jacket and tie. One of the crew held up a joking sign pointing to this man, NASA official George Abbey. George William Samuel Abbey bore the title Director of Flight Operations, NASA Johnson Space Center, JSC. He was in charge of mission control, astronaut selection and training, and the all-important flight assignments. But while Abbey was well known within the JSC family, he was a mystery, rarely interviewed, shy of the limelight. Even at NASA, few knew that he had been an Air Force pilot, specifically a helicopter instructor, before turning to engineering, or that he had worked on the Air Force's dinosaur space plane, or that he was with the Apollo 1 astronauts the night before the fatal fire that killed them in January 1967, then took part in the grim task of disassembling the charred vehicle in search of a cause, and went on to play a key role in managing NASA's recovery from that tragic incident, resulting in the Apollo 11 landing little more than 2 years later. Or that he was in mission control the night of the Apollo 13 accident and helped organize the famous recovery effort. Or that he led NASA's recruitment of women and minorities as space shuttle astronauts. On that November 1982 day of the STS-5 launch, Abbey was only halfway through his NASA career. Over the next 19 years, he would suffer through the agony of the Challenger disaster, ultimately losing his powerful position in Houston and being exiled to NASA HQ, where, in a miracle of bureaucratic maneuvering and sheer will, he not only survived but prospered, helping to reshape NASA while reinventing America's human space program. He would return to Houston in 1994 to run the Johnson Space Center, guiding the Space Shuttle program and leading the development of the International Space Station, all the while mentoring a new generation of NASA and aerospace leaders. In 2010, the head of NASA, the director of the Johnson Space Center, and the director of Russia's Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center were all astronauts or cosmonauts he had assigned to space flights. The week after the International Space Station was declared complete, Dan Golden, the same NASA administrator whom Abbey had served so completely that the pair had become known within the agency by a single moniker, Chief Dan George, fired Abbey. No one claims that Abbey is the most important figure in the history of America's human spaceflight. Abbey himself vigorously disputes such a characterization, insisting that he was always a small player on a large team. His idol, George Lowe, was far more central to the success of Apollo. Vital decisions about the Space Shuttle and International Space Station were made by others. Pioneering astronauts risked their lives and died. What makes Abbey unique is that during 37 years at NASA, he worked for or with all of them. He was an engineer, an administrator, a department head, a staffer, and finally a center director and program manager whose control over the Johnson Space Center was so complete that it became known as his fiefdom. He was also brilliant and hardworking, sometimes sentimental but also cold-eyed, blessed with a fantastic memory and a willingness to learn lessons, then apply them. A family man and father, he sometimes treated his subordinates like children, guiding their careers whether or not they knew it or wanted it. Astronaut Thomas Kenneth Mattingly said, "I've never known anyone who had a better read on people than George Abbey." He did this all in the service of a single but universal goal, allowing humans to live and work in space. Much like F. Scott Fitzgerald's movie mogul Monroe Starr from The Last Tycoon, one of those rare persons who had the entire equation of motion pictures in their heads, George Abbey held the entire equation of human spaceflight in his head. At every step of his professional journey, Abbey created a mystique that divided his colleagues, subordinates, and superiors. One group labeled him the Dark Lord and accused him of being a Godfather type who runs a patronage system, comparing his management style to J. Edgar Hoover's. A NASA flight surgeon called Abbey a dictator. Another astronaut dubbed him a rapacious powermonger. Yet another dismissed him with a single epithet, snake. But there were many others who said, for example, George Abbey saved the space program 4 times, or George Abbey was the single human being most responsible for the ISS being in space and successful. Another veteran astronaut called Abbey the best program manager NASA ever had. One co-worker said Abbey was not only a real advocate for the human spaceflight business, but also one of the few who also understood it. Spaceflight, he concluded, was just in George's blood. It could be argued that, after the Columbia disaster of 2003, there would have been no human spaceflight at all if not for decisions made by George Abbey a decade earlier. Which is it? Was George Abbey some kind of space-age Thomas Cromwell, skillfully using his intelligence and experience to convince an entire nation to embrace his vision for human spaceflight? Or was he a shadowy puppet master, a cold manipulator like some space-age Iago, bending not just astronauts, but all of NASA to his iron will for over 30 years? And both camps, pro and con, wonder openly, how did he do it? Where did the power come from? His considerable intelligence, his fantastic memory, his experience, his methods? Did he have a philosophy? If so, what was it? The story begins on a deserted roadside. Part 1. Don't Send Me There. 1. October Sky. October can be lonely on the plains of Montana. Temperatures might reach 60 degrees Fahrenheit during the day, but they fall fast at sunset, to freezing and below. The wind can be biting. And U.S. Route 12 on the long eastbound stretch between Missoula and Helena is not the place you want to pull to the side of the road. Even during daylight, there's not much to see, except scrub, clusters of pines, low rounded hills. Unless you're looking at the sky. It is Sunday, October 6, 1957, early evening. A 1955 Oldsmobile sits by the eastbound side of the highway. There are pockets of early snow on the darkened dirt to either side, but there's no traffic beyond the odd slow-moving semi or pickup truck. A young man leans against the driver's side, staring to the west. He is short and slim, with dark hair, and is wearing blue slacks and a windbreaker. The clothing is not suited to the weather. His name is George Abbey. He is a first lieutenant in the U.S. Air Force, a helicopter instructor at Randolph Air Force Base near San Antonio. He is driving back to Texas from his hometown of Seattle, where he was visiting family. It's a trip he's made from one starting point or another many times. Just a few years earlier, Abbey was a midshipman at the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis, coming off the summer cruise with 30 days leave and $3 a month spending money. In those days, his travel options were military transport, great if it was going where you wanted when you needed it, or family funds, not available. So Abbey and his roommate, Gordon Ivor, Gordy Dahl, another Seattle boy, found a third method. Knowing that car dealers in Detroit were eager to sell used vehicles in Seattle, the pair hitchhiked to Michigan, took a car, and headed out on U.S. Route 12 to Chicago, then across Wisconsin, Minnesota, the Dakotas, Montana, and Idaho into Washington State. Gas was covered. The trip was free, costing them only their time. Now, 3.5 years after graduating from Annapolis, Abbey is a married man with a car of his own. Between his basic officer's salary plus flight pay, he is pulling down $400 a month. Life is better. But Seattle remains a frequent destination. Abby's parents still live there, and so do two of his three brothers and a sister. Abby has grown to love the long drive from Texas north to Wyoming, then west across Montana and back. A fan of Western movies, especially John Ford's, Abby likes the bleak scenery and the famous big sky, especially on this particular evening. Tonight, Montana's big sky will allow Lieutenant Abbey a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to see the flight of an astronomical object by the name of Sputnik, the Earth's first artificial orbiting satellite. Abbey has always had an interest in space travel, the happy result of a youth spent reading Buck Rogers comics and watching Flash Gordon movie serials. He also knows that the United States is preparing to launch a small scientific satellite named Vanguard. But the news that broke the day before, as he was driving across western Washington state, has shocked him. The Soviet Union, the red communist enemy halfway around the world, fired a giant rocket from some mystery location in Central Asia, putting Sputnik into orbit. As the miles passed, Abbey heard more details. Sputnik was a silvery sphere 23 inches in diameter and weighing 184 pounds, small enough to fit inside the trunk of his Olds, though the Soviet satellite is a giant compared to the planned 3-pound Vanguard. Sputnik is circling the Earth every 92 minutes at an altitude ranging from a low point of 139 miles to a high of 900, flying as far north as Alaska and Greenland and as far south as Antarctica. It emits a beep that has been tracked all over the world. Abbey knows what this accomplishment implies. The Soviets do indeed possess the giant rockets they bragged about earlier in the year, missiles capable of flinging H-bombs over the North Pole to blow up New York and Washington, D.C. As a cold warrior, he's troubled. But as a pilot and Buck Rogers fan, he's also fascinated. Hearing on the radio earlier this day that Sputnik might be visible to Montana residents this very night, Abbey has pulled off the road to see. He glances at his watch, and there's Sputnik, moving swiftly from northwest to southeast, a small, bright dot. Abbey has seen shooting stars before, but this is different. Shooting stars vanish in a second or less. This light in the October sky remains steady. A satellite. He is stunned by the sight of it, and surprised by the depth of his reaction, feeling a bit like St. Paul on the road to Damascus. He has grown up with rockets, seen newsreel footage of German V-2s rising to incredible altitudes over New Mexico. He knows about the V-2's descendant, the Redstone, and its rival cousin, the Atlas. But it isn't until this moment that he connects them all, satellites, rockets, high-speed aircraft, the chance to see Earth from orbit, to walk on the moon, to visit Mars. The space age is no longer that thing to come. It's here. If the Navy and aviation are in George Abbey's blood, his bones are space and rocketry. He gets back in his car. Texas is still many hours away. 2. The Abbeys. Abbey's parents, Sam and Brenta, met on a London double-decker bus during World War I. Sam, recovering from wounds suffered while serving with the Canadian Army at the Battle of Saint-Éloi Craters in April 1916, was a passenger. Brenta was the ticket taker. Of Scottish descent, Sam had been born in 1890 in London, but spent his early years with his father, who was working in Bloemfontein, South Africa. Sam recalled watching one of the battles of the Second Boer War from a hillside there. His father fell ill and returned to London in 1902, where Sam completed secondary school. He then became a professional soccer player in Amsterdam. Eventually, he moved to the United States to work on an uncle's farm near Boston. He followed the wheat harvest to Western Canada, becoming, at one time or another, a member of the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, a boxer, and a fireman. In August 1914, Sam was working for the Canadian Pacific Railway in Kamloops, British Columbia. A train loaded with fellow workers from down track came through Kamloops. When asked where they were going, they said the war had started, and they were bound for Vancouver to go fight the Kaiser. Sam jumped on and, arriving in Vancouver, enlisted in the Canadian Army and was subsequently shipped to France. Brenta, born Bridget Gibby in Luarn, Carmarthenshire, Wales, was 4 years younger. Her mother had died when she was 10, and Brenta had been left to take care of a younger sister, Edith, for several years. She also worked as a servant for a family in Carmarthen until moving to London in 1912, when she went to work for the bus company. The two married in England and soon had a son, James Robert David, born October 8, 1917, in Cardigan, Wales, while Brenta was visiting an older sister. Sam had been given only one name. To make up for that lack, all of Brenta and Sam's children would carry three given names. After Sam served a year in the Army of Occupation in Europe, the couple moved to Canada in 1919, where Sam enrolled at the University of British Columbia in Vancouver, working his way through college as a farmer and salmon fisherman. In 1922, at the urging of friends in Washington State, the Abbeys moved to Seattle, where Sam joined the Continental Can Company, eventually becoming the company's transportation manager for the Pacific Northwest and Alaska. The family expanded. A second son, John Lloyd Richard Jack, followed on March 28, 1922. Then came Vincent Hugh Donald on July 10, 1923, and a fourth son on August 21, 1932, George William Samuel, born in the house at 505 North 71st Street. A fifth child, Phyllis Gwendolyn Brenta, was born there on March 28, 1934. The Abbeys had the typical first-generation immigrant virtues. Work hard, study hard, become part of the community, vote for Democrats. Brenta made dinner for the family every Sunday, a practice George himself would continue well into his 80s. Her dishes tended to be traditional, like Yorkshire pudding. There were jokes, a lot of teasing and pranking. Also music. Brenta made sure there was a piano in the house. Sam had a fine singing voice and appeared in local operas. He also had an entrepreneurial side, investing in several cottages in the town of White Rock, on Semiahmoo Bay, a few miles north of the U.S.-Canadian border. When school was out for the summer, George and Phyllis and Brenta could be found in White Rock, where the children spent long days on the beach, swimming, rafting, crabbing, and fishing, or visiting a nearby dairy farm in Milner that belonged to one of Sam's friends. Unusual for Americans in those days, Sam was not a member of any church. In fact, he was openly critical of organized religions. Family members ascribed this to his experiences in the trenches, where he had been surrounded by the sudden and daily death of friends and companions. Agnostic or not, Sam Abbey had all kinds of rules for proper behavior, most of them easily summed up by three words, do what's right. Brenta was Presbyterian and raised the children in that faith, though young George made his own religious conversion. In order to spend time with high school friends of Scandinavian descent, he began to attend their Lutheran church one block from the Abbey House, and would remain a regular Lutheran churchgoer for the rest of his life. One lure was the church's slate of activities. George joined the Boy Scout troop there in order to go camping in the mountains. Another attraction was a youth choir with several pretty blonde singers. Sam lived a healthy life, no smoking, no drinking, no cursing. He was squarely built and remained fit into his 80s. He kept playing football, meaning soccer. He contemptuously referred to the American game as carry ball. Immigrants from England, Wales, and Italy, football nations, kept their sporting traditions alive by forming teams centered around Pacific Northwest mining communities like Black Diamond and Ravensdale. George remembered watching his father playing for the Maple Leafs at Woodland Park during the 1930s. spending many a Sunday afternoon on damp fields with the cold seeping through the thin soles of his shoes. Sam and his Maple Leafs were repeat winners of the Washington State Championship. When Sam got too old to play right wing or even goalie, he would referee matches, especially those involving sailors from the British battleship HMS Warspite, which had been severely damaged in a battle off Crete in May 1941 and sent through the Suez Canal, then across the Indian and Pacific Oceans for repairs at the Puget Sound Naval Shipyard. It was while watching Sam and the Warspite sailors on a cold Sunday, December 7, 1941, that 9-year-old George learned of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. George was also an athlete, playing American football in spite of his slight stature, though he preferred basketball, hockey, and, when he could find Seattle boys who wanted to play the game, soccer. He was pretty much a straight arrow, like his father. Not that he had much opportunity for mischief. Large families have their own means of discipline. In the Abbey family, in addition to Father Sam, two of George's older brothers, Vince and Jack, often provided day-to-day authority. After Sam joined the U.S. Army for World War II service, and with his brothers also away serving in the military, George inherited the responsibility of helping Brenta and Phyllis. During the 1940s, the skies of Seattle were filled with Boeing B-17 and B-29 bombers. As many as 350 rolled out of the plant each month during peak production, inspiring a whole generation of flyers and engineers, including George Abbey. But Seattle was also a Navy town, home to the Pacific Fleet. George would remember Sam taking the family to Elliott Bay to see the big battleships anchored there. George was fond of Clear for Action, a 1940 novel by Stephen Meader dealing with the adventures of a young midshipman aboard the USS Constitution in the War of 1812. He also read H. Irving Hancock's two series about a cadet at West Point and a midshipman at Annapolis, and was a fan of C.S. Forrester's Hornblower stories in the Saturday Evening Post. When Sam volunteered for duty with the U.S. Army in World War II, he shaved 10 years off his actual age in order to enlist. Years later, he would volunteer for Korea and Vietnam. If there was a war, his granddaughter Suzanne said, he wanted to fight in it. After being commissioned a captain in the Transportation Corps, Sam arrived in Antwerp, Belgium, in October 1944, just as the Germans began shelling the port city with V-1 and V-2 rockets. The V-2s were in fact the brainchild of George's future NASA associate, Werner von Braun. London was a famous target for the V-2, but Antwerp was hit by more missiles. Belgian fatalities numbered over 3,700, with 6,000 wounded during the V-weapon blitz, which lasted into March 1945. There were over 600 American casualties, too, and Sam Abbey came close to joining that list. His office was in the city's King's Cross, which took at least 2 direct hits and suffered several near misses. While Sam was away searching for replacement windows, another V-2 struck. He returned to his office to find it destroyed. His last assignment in Europe was overseeing freed Soviet prisoners of war who had been used as slave laborers by the Nazis. With the European war ending in May, Sam returned to the United States in late June with orders to the Pacific to fight the Japanese. The announcement of the Japanese surrender on August 14, 1945, found him on leave in Seattle before his departure for his Pacific assignment. The entire family served in the military, or in support of it. George's older brothers, Jim and Jack, had been in military service even before the start of World War II. Jim as a Navy warrant officer, Jack as a lieutenant junior grade in the U.S. Naval Reserve assigned to the Merchant Marine, seeing combat during most of the island landings in the Pacific and at Kiska and Attu in the Aleutians. Vince had enlisted in the Army when the United States entered the war in December 1941, and Brenta worked on a Boeing assembly line during the course of the war. When George graduated from Lincoln High in 1950, It was only logical that he would want to follow the family tradition, in his case, to become a naval aviator. The Navy had pilots, but they guided surface ships, not aircraft. This in spite of the fact that the closest he had come to flying was seeing a Ford trimotor up close at Boeing Field when he was 6. George was enrolled at the University of Washington as a U.S. Naval Reserve Officers Training Corps, NROTC, student when Vince decided to help him out. The Abbeys lived within walking distance of UW. Sam had moved them there from North 71st while Jack and Vince were students at the university. George hoped to live at home and have an easy commute. But Vince, now at law school in Washington, D.C., felt that George ought to be away from home. It would be good for him, and he would be less of a burden to Sam and Brenta. So Vince looked into appointments to the service academies and discovered that West Point's quota was already filled, but not the Naval Academy at Annapolis. Vince sent George's grades and NROTC information to the appropriate political powers, and suddenly George found himself scheduled to take the Annapolis exams, for which he was completely unprepared. Refusing his brother was not an option. He reported to the federal building in downtown Seattle on the appointed date for a miserable experience, failing to complete 2 of the 5 sections and guessing at the answers to far too many questions. But when he received his grades shortly thereafter, he found he had passed, barely. A quick redo of his NROTC physical followed at Fort Lawton, and he was off to Annapolis to be sworn in on June 17, 1950, a little more than 1 week before the outbreak of the Korean War, for 4 years of sometimes unhappy schooling and indoctrination. Years later, when running the astronaut office and later the Johnson Space Center, George Abbey would be criticized for rearranging people's lives and careers. He had been the victim of the same sort of paternalistic manipulation himself. 3. Annapolis. Partly because of the circumstances of his enrollment, partly to Annapolis's awful climate, but mostly due to hazing at the hands of upperclassmen and general Naval Academy discipline, Abbey quickly concluded that he had made a huge mistake, envying friends who had gone to UW or other civilian universities. "I don't know anyone who enjoyed his plebe year," he would say later. He was assigned to a room in Bancroft Hall with 2 roommates, Gordy Dahl and another prep school athlete, Dave McGinnis. Dahl and McGinnis immediately landed on the plebe football team, and McGinnis later started for the academy baseball team. The trio would become lifelong friends, despite some early misunderstandings. "You faced an exam every day in every class," Abbey recalled. "Dahl and McGinnis told me that there was no way you could study for them, since the subject would always be a surprise. You either knew the answer or you didn't. I followed that advice for a month, and it was disastrous. So I began studying and did better." By his 2nd and 3rd years, Abbey grew to appreciate Annapolis. He made other friends, though largely within his company. Through John Sollers, another Seattle boy in the class of 53, he got to know Frank Leithan, also 53, a Wisconsin native. In addition to playing soccer, intramural football, basketball, and softball, Abbey excelled academically and graduated 128th out of 855 with high marks, top 5, in history, his favorite class. His least favorite was thermal engineering, the useful if dull study of the boilers that powered naval vessels. Nevertheless, Annapolis changed him as much as it changed the noted science fiction writer and prophet of space travel Robert A. Heinlein, an Annapolis grad who described the experience like this. "Take a young boy, before he has been out in the business world, tell him year after year that his most valuable possession, and practically his only one, is his personal honor. Tell him that he will never be rich, but that he stands a chance of having his name inscribed in Memorial Hall. Entrust him with secrets. Feed him on tales of heroism." These methods produced officers and gentlemen who adhered to a stringent code of behavior which is what allowed them to command expensive armed vessels sailing alone in some distant ocean, frequently in bad weather. The honor code at Annapolis was strict when it came to lying, cheating, and stealing, and required midshipmen to report such violations should they learn of a fellow's transgression. Unlike at West Point Military Academy, however, the Annapolis Code did not require a midshipman to report violations of the other academy rules and regulations that were usually punishable by demerits. Largely abiding by the regs, Abbey nevertheless accumulated demerits, though he couldn't rival the exploits of some of his associates, several of whom routinely went over the wall in search of less formal interactions with women, or just to drink and raise hell. George Nutkowski frequently vanished over the wall, among other risky activities. Stocky and uninhibited, Nutkowski played guard on the Academy's junior varsity, which frequently worked out against its varsity counterparts. On one of the JV's more successful plays, Nutkowski leveled his opposite number. While performing a chest-thumping victory dance over the opponent's prostrate form, he exuberantly proclaimed, "I hope you die!" Unfortunately for Nutkowski, Navy's coach Eddie Ertelatz was standing close enough to observe the display, which contributed significantly to the extension of Nutkowski's long and illustrious career on the junior varsity. As for other misbehavior, Abbey knew several midshipmen, including Gordy Dahl, who were secretly married against Academy rules. During their senior year, midshipmen were required to complete an application for security clearances. One of the questions was, "Are you married?" Other married midshipmen Abbey knew answered no, but Dahl felt he had to answer honestly, and he wrote yes. Obligingly, he even filled in the blank that asked for his wife's name. The form was processed through the Academy and in Washington, D.C., before someone discovered the yes and the wife's name on the form. Dahl had to resign just before graduation. He joined the U.S. Air Force ROTC at the University of Washington and received a commission upon graduation, becoming a pilot. By senior year, Abbey had his own girlfriend, drag in the Academy's brutal slang, Joyce Rokel Weiderman, the only daughter of Melvin and Gertrude Weiderman. Melvin was general manager of Rosenthal's, a well-known Baltimore department store. 4 years younger than George, Joyce was a student at the exclusive Bryn Mawr School, and, like many of her classmates, frequently drove down to Annapolis for social events. George had spotted her at a dance. Taking advantage of his status as an upperclassman, he'd asked one of his plebes to cut in on Joyce's partner, then cut in himself on the plebe. He and Joyce began to see each other, and during that year grew serious, eventually planning to marry once George had completed flight training and Joyce graduated from high school. The 1954 Lucky Bag, the Academy's yearbook, featured brief bios of each new officer. It described Abbey, lists among his likes popular music, traveling, reading, aviation, and sports. He has many hobbies, mostly along athletic lines such as skiing and golf. His military career got off to an early start as a Boy Scout. Even at such an early age, predictions were made as to how far he would go. It noted one other trait that Abbey would become famous for. He's well known for his unusual knack of falling asleep whenever the idea strikes him. It finished, "One of his foremost goals is to obtain $1 million and live in style. His good nature and his quiet, easy manner, as well as his never-say-die spirit, stand him in good stead. He should prove a credit to his chosen profession," which would not, however, be naval officer. He still believed in his teenage goal of flying. During his plebe year, he had made his first flight ever, a brief hop over Chesapeake Bay in the back seat of an ancient N3N biplane. The weather was suitable, he suffered no air sickness. He enjoyed the experience and was eager to repeat it. But Abbey had served on 3 summer cruises while at the Academy, first to Europe and Cuba, where he had his first beer, on the battleship USS Missouri, then to Newfoundland on the carrier USS Midway, and finally to Rio de Janeiro and Cartagena, Colombia, on the destroyer USS Brownson. While the cruises provided a welcome break from the academic year, he found the daily routine and standing watches, 4 hours on, 8 hours off, to be tedious and wearisome, particularly the mid-watches. The Navy required Academy graduates to serve 18 months or 2 years on a surface ship before they could even apply to attend flight school. Service in the U.S. Marine Corps was equally undesirable if you wanted to fly. The U.S. Marine Corps required young graduates to serve a year and a half or longer in infantry units before they could apply for flight school. Fortunately, there was a third possibility. The U.S. Air Force, which lacked a service academy, had the right to select up to 25% of each year's Annapolis or West Point class. Perhaps motivated by the surface duty requirement, 30% of Abbey's class opted for the Air Force, Abbey and McGinnis among them. This relatively new branch of the armed forces not only promised immediate pilot training and the lure of supersonic fighter jets, but also offered faster promotions. The faster promotions, Abbey wrote later, would turn out to be a myth, but that minor betrayal wouldn't be evident for a few years. 4. Air Force. To reward himself for completing 4 years at Annapolis, Second Lieutenant George W.S. Abbey bought his first car, a 1954 Mercury, and after managing to get to Detroit, drove it home from its factory to Seattle. There he traded it for his father's 1951 Mercury. Then he was off to Hondo Air Base, Texas, a World War II-era facility that had closed in 1945, then reopened as a civilian flight school soon thereafter. In 1951, with the Korean War increasing the need for pilots, the base had been reactivated by the Air Force, even though the base operator was a civilian contractor, Texas Aviation Industries. The facilities were aged and crude, hot and dusty. Abbey was quartered in an old barracks that, like most structures in those days, lacked air conditioning. He disliked it, but believed he could tolerate it for a few months, which is all the time he expected to spend in the state of Texas. As a member, at first, of Class 55 Sierra, Abbey was assigned to the Applejack flight section and to a civilian instructor named Alfred Slider. On his first day, he found himself in the cockpit of a Piper PA-18 Super Cub at Hondo's auxiliary runway, a dirt airstrip in the town of Castroville. Under Slider's patient guidance, Abbey quickly soloed and moved on to the North American T-6 Texan, the revered tail-dragging trainer with its 600-horsepower engine. Turning final in the T-6, the pilot opened the canopy. Flying off dirt strips, and this being Texas, the wind blew, kicking up dust and making takeoffs and landings interesting. "We wore goggles," Abbey later recalled. "When we finally stopped, we'd take them off and see that our faces were dirty everywhere. We looked like raccoons." Days at Hondo were regimented, with flying in the morning, academics in the afternoon. There was also physical conditioning. Free time was limited, not that there was much for the students to do, beers at the officers' club and forays to San Antonio. Abbey stayed in touch with Joyce Weiderman, writing frequently, and occasionally splurging on long-distance phone calls. He graduated with Class 55 Victor on April 2, 1955. However, he was not yet qualified to wear wings. On April 21, 1955, Abbey arrived at Webb Air Force Base at Big Spring, Texas, between Midland and Abilene, to commence basic single-engine training on the North American T-28A and then the Lockheed T-33. The day of his arrival, he learned that his instructor would be First Lieutenant William G. Kirk, Annapolis class of 1953. He and Kirk had not gotten along, and Abbey realized that Kirk had probably requested him as a student, relishing the chance to put me through my paces. Later that day, however, Kirk took off with a different student on a training flight. Their T-28A collided with another aircraft flown by an instructor and student. Both crashed, and all four pilots were killed. Conditions at Webb weren't much better than at Hondo. Abbey was assigned to another ancient barracks, where he and his roommate were forced to stuff towels into cracks around the windows in order to keep out the blowing dust, which didn't really work. Some mornings I'd wake up and find that our blankets were both covered with a fine sand. Abby enjoyed the T-28 and fell in love with the jet-powered T-33, logging dozens of happy hours flying at speeds up to 450 miles an hour, much faster than the prop-powered trainer. He also made a lifelong friend in Lieutenant Bob Alpert, an ROTC graduate from Colby College in Maine, who would leave the Air Force within a decade to become a success in rail, real estate, and steel. For years, Alpert would tell anyone who asked that George Abbey was the best pilot I've ever seen. As the basic phase came to a close, pilots in Abbey's group prepared to consider their next assignments. In the late summer of 1955, the Air Force needed B-47 pilots for the rapidly expanding Strategic Air Command, SAC, bomber fleet. Abbey was ranked high enough to be allowed to make a choice, and would have loved to fly the F-86D. Like many, possibly most of the new pilots at Webb, he didn't want to fly B-47s. That assignment meant a long-term commitment to the SAC, and worse yet, during that first year, every pilot would be trained to fly as a navigator. He had already decided that he wanted to be a test pilot, and felt he would be better qualified with an advanced engineering degree, as well as varied flying experience. An alternative arose, however. Abbey could become a helicopter pilot. It would be just as far removed from single-seat fighters as the SAC job, but it also promised to expose him to an entirely new type of flying machine. Surely that would be useful in his flight test career. The commitment was only 3 years as opposed to five. So he volunteered for what the military called rotary wing flight and received his wings on September 15, 1955. Leaving his friends, an unhappy bunch, now in the pipeline for the B-47, Abbey packed up and drove the Mercury out of Webb, headed for Baltimore, where he and Joyce were married 3 days later, on Sunday, September 18th. They spent their honeymoon in Quebec, then drove south to Abbey's new post, Edward Gary Air Force Base in San Marcos, Texas, the Air Training Command's 358th Pilot Training Wing, liaison helicopter. In 1955, Edward Gary Air Force Base was the U.S. military's primary helicopter training facility, with 22 squadrons and close to 5,000 personnel. Abbey and his new bride rented a room in a home that belonged to a professor at Southwest Texas State Teachers College. Their first days as a couple were happy ones, though life in rural Texas was a big change for Joyce. Her husband enjoyed the challenges of transitioning from fixed wing to rotary wing, first qualifying on the H-13 Sioux, known to a later generation of Americans as the helicopter in the television series MASH. The H-13 was built by Bell beginning in the 1940s. It was a two-bladed vehicle with one engine and a bubble-like cockpit. Underpowered, it was difficult to fly on hot Texas days with high temperatures. It was especially hard to keep it in the air when there was no wind. After 35 hours in the H-13, Abbey went on to fly the Sikorsky H-19 Chickasaw, a multi-purpose utility helicopter that was largely used for rescue work. Once he had completed H-19 training, Abbey's performance was sufficiently stellar that he was offered the chance to remain at Gary as an instructor. He was happy to accept, assuming that he and Joyce would be spared a change of station. He was wrong about that. The assignment had other attractions. Gary trained pilots from not only the Air Force, but also the Army and NATO partners, so Abbey was able to meet students from diverse backgrounds and traditions. At Gary, he was also able to fly aircraft other than helicopters. In the 1950s, the Air Force had no restrictions on the number and type of aircraft a pilot could remain current on, so Abbey returned to flying the T-28 while branching out to the Cessna L-19, which belonged to the Army liaison at Gary, and the twin-engine Beechcraft C-45. He also gained experience in a third helicopter, the Piasecki H-21 Workhorse Shawnee, originally developed as an Arctic rescue helicopter. There was also a North American B-25 bomber at Gary, and after one of the World War II vets at the base asked him to serve as co-pilot, Abbey got checked out in the venerable twin-engine Bird. His experiences in multi-engine flying were educational, since both the C-45 and B-25 were bigger than the trainers he had flown. As a helicopter flight instructor, Abbey's first goal was teaching his students to hover. New pilots tended to overcontrol and get wild. A key element in successful hovering, of course, was avoiding the ground. Once a student proved he could hover, then it was on to approaches, landings, and the vital auto-rotation, landing a helo without power. Eventually, Abbey had to be brave enough and confident enough in each student to let him solo. Essentially, he just hoped he had taught the student enough to keep him from killing himself. One lesson he learned, and would apply later at NASA, once your student knew the basics, let him fly, as much as possible, hands off. Abbey's time at Gary turned out to be brief. In early 1956, the Air Force announced that it would be closing the base in June and moving helicopter training to Randolph Air Force Base at San Antonio. This was but a minor disruption. San Antonio was only 50 miles from San Marcos. Construction on the huge facility at Randolph had begun in the 1920s, when the U.S. Army Air Corps decided it required an airfield designed specifically for flight training, a West Point of the Air, and incorporated a then-radical new layout. Buildings were generally constructed in the Spanish Colonial Revival style, of concrete bricks covered with stucco and roofs of Mission red clay tile. Even the hangars were Art Deco, with roofs painted in checkerboard. The base's most prominent structure was its administration building, known as the Taj Mahal. In 1956, Randolph was home to the Air Force's B-29 bomber training units. Other aircraft based there included the T-33, F-84E, and F-86, as well as helicopters. Abbey's senior officers at Randolph were World War II vets who had mostly flown fighters in that conflict. Some had flown helicopters in Korea. One of them, Bob Ferris, became a good friend. He and Abbey had the fun of flying an H-19 from Texas back to the Sikorsky factory in Connecticut, a journey of 1,800 miles or so. The H-19 was good for 300 miles between refuelings. So every time they needed gas, or even to grab a couple of Cokes, Abbey and Ferris would set down in some field near a country store, surprising the locals. Another sport for instructors and senior students was dropping low to chase jackrabbits. Abbey also flew search and rescue missions in the San Antonio area during massive floods that took place in the spring of 1957. His tour as an instructor would end in the fall of 1958, and throughout 1957, Abbey considered his next potential station. Topping the list was reassignment to an operational helicopter unit at Spangdahlem, Germany. Another possibility was F-86D interceptor pilot training, then a tour with the Continental Air Defense Command. There was, however, a third option, graduate school in engineering. And not long after his Sputnik sighting, Abbey requested an educational assignment to Purdue, or possibly the University of Michigan. He was told that all the fall 1958 slots in aeronautical engineering had been filled, that the only openings at Purdue and Michigan were in electrical engineering. Rather than wait another year, he accepted the placement in a master's program in electrical engineering. But instead of being sent to a civilian university, he was assigned to the Air Force Institute of Technology, AFIT, at Wright Field in Dayton, Ohio. He worked through the final months of his helicopter tour, watching as the Soviets launched the first living being into orbit, a dog named Laika, on Sputnik 2. He watched as America's first attempt to launch the Vanguard satellite ended in public failure on December 6th. But a team under Werner von Braun at the Army's Redstone Arsenal in Huntsville, Alabama, successfully placed America's Explorer 1 satellite in orbit on January 31, 1958. And the United States began to expand its space program, notably creating a new civilian space agency, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, using the facilities and personnel of the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, NACA. Since World War II, much of the NACA's work had been in rocketry and high-speed flight. The NACA's head, Hugh Dryden, would be NASA's first deputy administrator. T. Keith Glennon, president of Case Western Reserve University, was nominated as the incoming administrator. NASA opened for business on October 1, 1958. The Affetts' winter quarter began in early January 1958, and Abbey immediately regretted trading helicopter flying hours for hours of classwork in electronic circuits, radar, math, and communications, and for late evenings of intense study. He grew familiar with the Aeronautical Research Laboratory and, for the first time, used a computer to complete a thesis titled Near-Infrared Transmission by Cadmium Sulfide, a topic suggested by one of his professors. Abbey's electrical engineering class at Affetts numbered 16. One of them, his old Annapolis buddy, Frank Leithan, who had also gone into the Air Force after graduating a year ahead of Abbey. At 6'3" and 220 pounds, rarely without a cigar, Leithan was an outstanding pilot, and, except for a preference for polka music as opposed to Celtic, his interests matched up nicely with Abbey's. They would undertake a good number of T-33 proficiency flights to other Air Force bases throughout the country. On occasion, they visited Gordy Dahl, who was stationed at Truax Air Force Base in Madison, Wisconsin, Leithan's home state. In addition to his T-33 hops, Abbey had occasional access to an orphan H-13 that nobody else was qualified to fly. Abbey had his first encounters with potential astronauts at Wright, meeting Gus Grissom, assigned to the same base as a test pilot, Alan Shepard, and John Glenn when they were among 30 candidates undergoing psychological tests in March 1959. All were senior to Abbey in age and experience, but meeting them was a reminder that humans would indeed be flying in space within a year or two, and Abbey could be one of them. As he had with all his past schooling, Abbey did well at Affetts, scoring near the top of his class. By summer 1959, he was pondering his next post within the Air Force's massive Air Research and Development Command, then exploring not only advanced aircraft like the F-108 fighter and B-70 bomber, but also guided missiles. Leithan, who had come to Affetts from single-seat fighters, would go to the F-108 program office. He subsequently applied and was accepted to the U.S. Air Force Test Pilot School. With his helicopter background, Abbey knew he didn't qualify for test pilot training. A visit to the personnel office alerted him to an immediate opening in the Dinosaur program office at Wright Field. Dinosaur, its name a contraction of the term dynamic soaring, was a radical new step in high-altitude flight in which a dart-shaped piloted vehicle would be launched atop a Titan rocket to complete a single loop around the Earth, flying through reentry to a controlled landing at an airbase. Abbey was drawn to the idea because it combined a spacecraft and an aircraft, launching atop a rocket but landing on a runway. NASA's Mercury project used bell-shaped blunt-body craft that would launch atop a rocket but reenter the atmosphere like a warhead to splash down in the ocean. Some test pilots sneered at the idea, calling it spam in a can. Dinosaur was officially approved in October 1959, just as Abbey signed on. Boeing was to build the winged vehicle, and the Martin Company in Baltimore was to provide a launcher based on its Titan missile. When Abbey arrived at Building 14, just down the hill from Affet, there were only 10 people in the program under Colonel Walter M. Mickey Moore, a 43-year-old West Point graduate who had flown combat missions in Europe during World War II, then served as a test pilot, a wing commander, and more recently a student at the War College. He was energetic, blunt, well-liked, and determined to get Dinosaur flying. Moore also understood the value of mentorship and career building. He made Abbey the junior officer on the program, his Man Friday. Soon, Abbey was handling a variety of other tasks, from defining and negotiating Boeing's official statement of work, which dealt with the tedious details of government-furnished equipment and systems, to communicating with the Martin Company on the Titan launch vehicle, and with NASA. 5. Dinosaur. The Langley Research Center was a collection of ancient brick buildings, hangars, and wind tunnels on the Virginia coast near Hampton. Founded in 1917, it was the oldest of the former NACA labs that were absorbed into the new agency, NASA. Within the aeronautical community, Langley was famed for the dependable precision of its discoveries and reports, the so-called technical notes, and for the eccentricities of some of its staffers. In April 1960, it was home to the Space Task Group, a cadre of 70 engineers, secretaries, and computers, women who operated bulky calculating machines, later to be celebrated in the book and feature film Hidden Figures, 2016, running Project Mercury, America's first human spaceflight program. The Space Task Group was led by Robert Gilruth, a balding 47-year-old engineer. Born in Michigan, Gilruth received bachelor's and master's degrees in aeronautical engineering from the University of Minnesota in 1935 and 1936. He joined NACA in January 1937, where he pioneered standards for flying qualities in aircraft as well as data recording, and later worked in hypersonic research, including satellites. The seven Mercury astronauts, as members of NASA's Space Task Group under Gilruth, were based at Langley. Langley also housed a team that worked on the Air Force's Dinosaur. By spring 1960, Dinosaur had reached a critical phase in its design, moving from theory to hardware. All interested parties, from the Air Force and NASA to major contractors like Boeing and Martin, needed to agree on the path forward to certify such basics as the shape of the vehicle, its control systems, its aerodynamics, its thermal protection system, and its weight. With that end in mind, the Air Force and NASA scheduled the joint conference on lifting manned hypervelocity and reentry vehicles. Flying into nearby Langley Air Force Base that first week of April 1960 was Captain George W.S. Abbey. On Abbey's first day, he arrived at the center's gymnasium for a rehearsal of the conference, which was to be held the following week. He expected a dry run-through of all the papers, possibly with a helpful comment or request for clarification. What he found was veteran NASA engineer John Stack sitting at a desk on a stage at one end of the gym, facing an audience of unruly NASA engineers who blithely wandered in and out as they wished. No military discipline here. The first engineer approached a podium to talk through his slides on the Dinosaur thermal protection system, designed to protect the spacecraft from reentry temperatures of thousands of degrees. The audience leaped on that first slide, and every other slide, questioning each conclusion, each equation, each underlying assumption, even the typeface. There was shouting, there were red faces, there were expressions of violent disbelief. Finally, mercifully, Stack hammered his gavel. The presenter was told the changes that must be made. Then he slunk off the stage. Abbey had barely recovered from this display when a second presenter threw a slide up on the projector, and the free-for-all resumed. This went on all day. With the assistance of his NASA contact at Wright Field, Peter Koroshinsky, Abbey began to identify some of the participants. Bob Gilruth glided in and out of the conference, much like the bemused father of an unruly family. Another man in his 40s, George Lowe, the aerodynamics specialist who was head of manned spaceflight at NASA's HQ in Washington, watched the bloodbath with serene detachment. One of the most persistently vocal critics was a tiny man who could barely sit still. Koroshinsky told Abbey, "That's Max Faget," who happened to be the genius behind the basic Mercury spacecraft. Abbey realized that engineering wasn't purely numbers and science, that there was always room for interpretation and even opinion, but this wire brushing, it would never have happened in the Air Force. Briefers in the Dinosaur Program Office were treated with respect and deference. Colonel Moore was occasionally blunt and a practitioner of chain-of-command management, but he was willing to listen and, if motivated to comment on what he heard, to do so quietly. Bill Lamar might have been one of the world's experts on aerodynamics, but he would never have challenged Moore in public the way Max Faget did his NASA boss. The session ended. Abbey emerged into the Langley afternoon to find that kegs of beer had been set up outside the gym. And there was Max Faget, joshing with one of his many victims as if nothing unpleasant had happened. The drinking and kidding continued well past dinner time, and Abbey had to drag himself back to bachelor officer quarters. The next day, the battle resumed. By this time, Abbey was able to enjoy the spectacle. What surprised him most, however, was the conference itself, when the NASA presentations, the product of those painful batterings, sailed through with no criticism or challenges. It was the presentations from non-NASA scientists and contractors that meandered or failed or otherwise led to hushed rebuttals in the hallways that would have to be discarded or rethought. Abbey learned a vital lesson from this experience. Engineering worked best when subjected to immediate face-to-face peer review. Also, you could have serious disagreements about data and still be friendly. And beer had its uses, too. 6. Boeing. Shortly after 8 in the morning on Friday, May 5th, 1961, Captain Abbey stopped by the Wright Field cafeteria on his way to work. As he was getting a cup of coffee, he noticed that the radio was playing NBC from Florida, with coverage of the launch of Navy Commander Alan Shepard on the first manned Mercury mission. Abbey had expected the launch. He knew that NASA had had to scrub the first attempt on May 2nd. He hadn't anticipated being able to hear the live coverage. The Soviet Union had made the first manned spaceflight, sending 27-year-old pilot Yuri Gagarin on a single orbit of the Earth in a spacecraft called Vostok, meaning East, on April 12th. The event had surprised Abbey, but since he, like most space professionals, had expected a Soviet flight at some point, it wasn't the shock Sputnik was. Abbey sat down alone at a table, listening as NASA worked through several holds in the countdown. Finally, at 8:34 a.m. CST, Mercury's Redstone rocket ignited, and Shepard was on his way, rocketing to an altitude of 116 miles, heading 303 miles downrange. Only when Abbey heard word of Shepard's safe splashdown did he rise to go back to work. 2 months later, on July 19, 1961, former Wright test pilot Gus Grissom repeated Shepard's flight, arcing to an altitude of 116 miles and flying 300 miles downrange from Cape Canaveral. The early ejection of the Mercury capsule hatch caused the vehicle to flood. Grissom was forced to swim for his life. In mid-August, the Soviets launched a second cosmonaut, German Titov, on a Vostok mission that lasted an entire day. In January 1961, newly elected President John F. Kennedy took office, bringing new leadership not only to NASA, where wily political operator James Webb replaced the more academic Keith Glennon, but also to the Department of Defense. The new secretary, Robert McNamara, former president of the Ford Motor Company, examined America's massive and expensive military complex of bombers, submarines, missiles, and ground forces for potential cost reductions. He questioned the need for a new supersonic fighter, the F-108, a supersonic bomber, the B-70, and a nuclear missile launched from a bomber, the GAM-87 Skybolt, and soon canceled all three. Dinosaur was in McNamara's sights, too, but there the news was better. The new secretary expanded Dinosaur's mission from hypersonic research to actual orbital flight, a goal that seemed more achievable in the spring and summer of 1961 than it had earlier. Abbey welcomed the decision to make Dinosaur an orbital program, though it now required a more powerful booster than the original Titan I, creating a host of technical problems. On May 25, 1961, President Kennedy had proposed, and Congress had supported, the goal of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to Earth by the end of the decade. This $20 billion effort, Project Apollo, would be managed by NASA, the organization Abbey had been working with since 1959. By September 1961, he would have been assigned to Wright Field for 3 years, including his time at AFIT. This Apollo project was something entirely new and exciting, far surpassing even Dinosaur's goal of winged orbital flight. Abbey looked at Apollo with a bit of envy, but saw no way to get involved. Air Research and Development Command had decided to assign development engineers to a contractor's facility, Boeing, in the case of Dinosaur. Mickey Moore and the program leaders felt that Abbey might be a good choice. When the possibility was first raised, Abbey, having grown canny about these matters, protested, "Oh, don't send me there." His ploy worked. Assigned to the new development engineering office at Boeing, Abbey made the long drive to Seattle the first week in September. Joyce, son George Jr., and a baby girl, also named Joyce Brenta Catherine, Joyce B.K., flew out a few weeks later. Returning to Abbey's beloved Seattle, they first moved in with Sam and Brenta, which allowed grandparents and grandchildren to get to know each other. George Sr.'s older brother, Vince, and younger sister, Phyllis, and their families were in the area, too. Abbey eventually found a house in Seattle's Magnolia District, not far from Sam and Brenta's. It rested on the edge of a hill so steep that riding up and down the incline frightened George Jr. Abbey immensely enjoyed being back in his hometown. He was surrounded by family and old friends, had important work, and could take advantage of the city's outdoor activities. "I could leave Boeing at 5:30 in the afternoon and be in the mountains within an hour. They had night skiing, so I could ski until 9:30. Moving to Seattle at the same time was Lieutenant Colonel Jim Wiley, 43, who held a physics degree from the University of Pittsburgh and had served in World War II as a fighter pilot with the Tuskegee Airmen. The Abbeys were raised to be free of racial prejudice, an ideal that had been severely tested in the fall of 1944. Vince was then training to be a Japanese linguist in Army intelligence. He telephoned home in mid-November to tell Brenta that two of his friends would be passing through Seattle at Thanksgiving. Would she invite them for dinner? "Of course," she replied. 12-year-old George and 10-year-old Phyllis were sent to meet the two soldiers at the streetcar downtown. They discovered that the two were Japanese Americans, known in those days as Nisei. The kids brought them to the house and watched as Brenta welcomed them as if they were members of the family, a lesson George would remember all his life. 16 years later, Abbey offered to help Lieutenant Colonel Wiley find a place to live. For several evenings, the pair drove to different parts of Seattle looking at new homes and developments. Abbey had telephoned ahead and received eager encouragement from landlords happy to host an Air Force officer and pilot. But when Abbey and Wiley showed up, things changed. Whenever Wiley expressed interest in a property, there was some new problem, or even a suggestion that the colonel might consider locating in a different part of the city, an obvious hint that he should look in neighborhoods more hospitable to people of color. Abbey had witnessed other officers in the dinosaur program treating Wiley poorly, often ignoring his suggestions. This latest snub from hometown folks left Abbey embarrassed and angry. On February 20, 1962, astronaut John Glenn, a Marine Corps lieutenant colonel, made the first American manned orbital flight, circling the Earth three times in dramatic fashion, splashing down safely in spite of a fear that his vehicle's heat shield had come loose. Navy Lieutenant Commander Scott Carpenter followed in May 1962, largely repeating Glenn's three-orbit mission with his own dramatics, running short of fuel to control his spacecraft's attitude and splashing down 250 miles from recovery forces. Navy Commander Wally Schirra launched on a six-orbit Mercury mission on October 3, 1962, and completed it without heart-stopping moments. The Soviets conducted two more Vostok missions, too. At the same time, NASA was hiring a new group of astronauts for Gemini, a spacecraft capable of carrying two astronauts, and Apollo. Abbey had seen the announcement back in May and would have loved to apply, but applicants had to be graduates of military test pilot schools or employed as civilian test pilots. He was neither. Like the Mercury program, Dinosaur had astronauts, though they were not given that title, but instead called pilot consultants. Based at Edwards Air Force Base, they were required to support other Edwards development, flying Pace and Chase, for example. One of the men would visit Wright, and later Boeing, for a week at a time. The senior pilot was Major Jim Wood, a finalist for Mercury who had been rejected. Nevertheless, he was highly regarded as a pilot and engineer. There were three other Air Force test pilots, Pete Knight, Hank Gordon, and Russ Rogers. Abbey would grow to know all of them well, finding Rogers especially capable. NASA had three pilots in the Dinosaur program, the most senior being Milton Thompson, a Navy World War II veteran from Minnesota. The others were Bill Dana and Neil Armstrong. Dana left the program in early 1962 to concentrate on other NASA programs at Edwards. Then, in September, Armstrong was selected for the 1962 NASA astronaut group. Unhappy with the number of civilian pilots in their military program, Dinosaur officials replaced Dana and Armstrong with Captain Albert Cruz. That same month, Dinosaur, now designated X-20A, had its public unveiling at a meeting of the Air Force Association in Las Vegas. Its future seemed bright. But Dinosaur faced an enemy, and it was neither the Soviets nor some insurmountable technical challenge. It was the Aerospace Corporation, a nonprofit research and engineering company that had been created to provide technical management to all Air Force missile and space systems. It was able to pay higher salaries than the Air Force offered its engineers and to keep people assigned to programs for years at a time, providing continuity. While in Los Angeles for yet another Dinosaur review early in 1963, Abbey learned firsthand that Aerospace wanted to scrap the space plane in favor of Blue Gemini, a series of military-manned orbital missions that would use NASA's Gemini spacecraft. Blue Gemini would lead to a military-manned space station to be launched by the Titan 3C. This idea fit perfectly with McNamara's philosophy, expressed by the Defense Secretary in a briefing in January 1963. If the United States was researching controlled reentry from orbit, NASA should be the responsible agency, and migrating the civilian-developed Gemini to operational military uses would save vast sums of development money. Abbey didn't accept McNamara's reasoning. NASA had been involved with Dinosaur from the beginning, and if the program's scope had evolved beyond pure hypersonic research, it was because McNamara wanted it that way. Dinosaur lived on, managed from right field, but George Abbey had learned a new and valuable lesson. There wasn't just one Air Force. In May 1963, Air Force Major Gordon Cooper flew Mercury Atlas 8, the fourth and final orbital mission in the program, circling the Earth 18 times in 33 hours. It struck Abbey as an impressive achievement. After all, Mercury had originally been designed to put an astronaut in space for three orbits, little more. It was a testament to the space agency that engineers had found a way to improve and enhance the vehicle. 3 weeks later, Cooper's mission looked less notable. On June 14th, the Soviets launched cosmonaut Valery Bykovsky aboard Vostok 5, and he remained in space for 5 days. Worse yet for American space prestige, on June 16th, Vostok 6 was launched, carrying a woman cosmonaut named Valentina Tereshkova. The 26-year-old wasn't even a pilot. She was a parachutist recruited for space training. She logged as much time in space during her 70-hour flight as all the Mercury astronauts combined. Tereshkova's flight also triggered a great many newspaper editorials and letters to NASA, asking when the agency would put an American woman in space, or why there were no woman astronauts. Abbey knew the answer, of course. NASA desired experienced test pilots for its program, and under the restrictive practices of the day, there weren't many women who had acquired such a background. In spite of battles between Wright and Los Angeles, by November 1963, the first Dinosaur flight vehicle was taking shape on the factory floor at Boeing. The first piloted orbital flight would be in July 1966, one of eight that would continue into 1968. On Friday, November 22, 1963, the Dinosaur office at Boeing hosted a group of students from the Aerospace Research Pilot School Class 63B. Among them was Abbey's friend Frank Lethen, and also Jim Irwin, another pilot he'd met and flown with at Wright Field. Three members of the class were absent. A month earlier, David Scott and Ted Freeman had been selected as members of the third group of NASA astronauts, and they were planning to relocate to Houston. Lethen had applied, but had been rejected as too tall. Abbey had considered applying, but wasn't eager to leave Dinosaur at this stage, and felt his high-performance jet time was insufficient. A third member also failed to make the trip. Captain Ed Dwight, an African-American pilot whose enrollment in the U.S. Air Force Aerospace Research Pilot School, ARPS, had been ordered by the Kennedy administration over the vehement objections of ARPS Commandant Chuck Yeager, who didn't believe that Dwight, whose flying background was in bombers, qualified. Suddenly, a secretary received a phone call that President Kennedy had been shot in Dallas. Everyone turned on radios and televisions, and soon Abbey and the others heard the word. Kennedy was dead. The news turned what would have been a reunion of old friends into a wake as the pilots discussed the impact of Kennedy's death on the world, the nation, and the space program. On Tuesday, December 10th, Abbey arrived at the Dinosaur office at Boeing to learn, via a phone call from Colonel Moore's office, that McNamara had canceled the program, making the announcement in a Pentagon news conference. There would be no reprieve. The Air Force had had four super program offices when McNamara became Secretary of Defense. Dinosaur was the final one to be canceled. The pilots simply returned to their duties at Edwards. The Boeing engineers would be assigned elsewhere within the company. After closing out several Dinosaur contracts and research efforts, Abbey quickly found new work at Boeing. He supported the supersonic transport, SST, program being built by the company and, thanks to his contacts at NASA Langley, also joined the team building the Lunar Orbiter, a series of unmanned probes scheduled to be launched to the moon in 1965 to take high-resolution photographs of possible Apollo landing sites. He was also able to fly acceptance tests on new KC-135 tankers and C-135 transports as they rolled off the Boeing production lines, then to deliver the vehicles to their new units. When not doing acceptance or delivery flights, he flew with the Air Defense Command's 325th Fighter Wing at nearby McCord Air Force Base in Tacoma. He hoped that the increased flight time and the variety of flying experience would qualify him for acceptance at ARPS. He wasn't building a winged spacecraft any longer, but he might have the opportunity to fly in NASA's Apollo spacecraft. Elsewhere, Major General Samuel Phillips, program manager for the Minuteman Intercontinental Ballistic Missile, ICBM, became Apollo program director at NASA headquarters. Abbey had met Phillips during one of his trips to Boeing. Abbey already knew the Phillips legend, how one Friday he had briefed the new President Kennedy on the progress of the Minuteman missile and on Monday was promoted to Brigadier General. Phillips felt that NASA needed engineers with experience in program management. With his experience at Dinosaur's program office and prior experience with NASA, Abbey became a candidate. He received orders to visit Houston to interview for a position in the Apollo Program Office's System Engineering Division. He flew there in October 1964 to meet with his potential new boss, Owen Maynard, and other engineers assigned to the program, including some he'd met on Dinosaur. During his week in Houston, Abbey developed immediate concerns about the state of the Apollo program and the number of yet unresolved issues, and, more surprisingly, the absence of any plan to correct them. And, coming from Seattle, he was also taken aback by the weather, unable to believe that humans would choose to live in such heat and humidity. During his previous assignments in Texas, he had experienced the heat, but not Houston's humidity. On Friday, his last day, Maynard asked him if he wanted to move to Houston and join the team. Abbey told him, "I don't want to work here." "Oh, come on, at least think about it over the weekend." "I won't change my mind. I don't want to come here." "Call us Monday." "Why? I don't want to come here." Abbey flew home, greatly relieved, and put NASA and Houston out of his mind. He didn't telephone Maynard on Monday. But as he was preparing to leave Boeing at about 5:30 that evening, the phone rang. It was Maynard. He said, "You haven't called." Abbey said, "I haven't changed my mind." "That's too bad," Maynard said, "because we told the Air Force last Friday that we wanted you, and they said fine, and they will be sending you orders reassigning you to the manned spacecraft center in Houston." Abbey knew that he was inevitably going to NASA, but if he had to join the space agency, he preferred to go to Langley in Virginia. He asked his contacts in the Lunar Orbiter office at Langley if they would write to General Phillips and explain the necessity of Captain Abbey's presence there. Phillips wrote back, "I'm very pleased to hear all that Captain Abbey is doing to support the Lunar Orbiter program. He has 30 days to complete all those activities and to report to Houston." Part 2. Before This Decade Is Out. 7. Destination Moon. In the first week of November 1964, George Abbey drove to Houston with two friends from the Seattle area who were seeking jobs at NASA. He moved into bachelor officer quarters at Ellington Air Force Base, 4 miles up the road from the Manned Spacecraft Center, MSC. His family, Joyce, 6-year-old George Jr., 4-year-old Joyce B.K., and 10-month-old Suzanne, would remain in Seattle until he got settled. On Monday, November 9th, Abbey reported to Owen Maynard on the 6th floor of Building 2, the tallest building at the MSC. The buildings and sidewalks were new, but the site looked raw. There was no real yard, just sprigs of St. Augustine grass in what was largely mud. Like Abbey, the 40-year-old Maynard was a pilot, having flown mosquito fighters for the Royal Canadian Air Force in World War II. He had then joined aircraft manufacturer Avro Canada while working his way through the University of Toronto, becoming one of the Canadian engineers recruited by NASA in 1959 after the cancellation of the CF-105 Aero fighter jet. During that recruitment interview, Maynard had volunteered as a pilot in the American Manned Space Program, and was, of course, instantly told no, making him the first Canadian to volunteer to become an astronaut and the first to be rejected. In the fall of 1964, he was head of the Systems Engineering Division, SED, within the Apollo Spacecraft Program Office, just one office in the giant effort that was Apollo. Flights to the Moon had been the staple of science fiction novels for over a century, and for two generations of motion pictures, pulp magazines, and comic books. George Abbey had devoured such stories. After World War II, the concept began to receive serious consideration from rocket pioneers like Wernher von Braun and, after Sputnik, from the U.S. Army, which authorized Braun to develop a series of heavy-lifting Saturn boosters. In 1959, with the Mercury manned satellite officially in progress, leaders of the new space agency agreed on a series of 9 future steps that began with Mercury's Earth orbital flight and culminated in the Mars-Venus landings. Lunar landing was step 7 and was being pushed hard by George Lowe of NASA Lewis and Max Faget of NASA Langley. By May 1961, Apollo's conceptual vehicle had begun to take shape. Its command module would be a blunt body cone equipped with a thermal protection system that would shield it from the heat of re-entering the Earth's atmosphere at 24,000 miles an hour. It would carry a crew of 3, the Navy-minded men of the Space Task Group assumed round-the-clock watches of 8 hours each, so it would need an environmental system that could support them in safety, if not comfort, for 2 weeks. The crew would need to be able to operate or fly the vehicle, so controls were needed in a workable cockpit layout. They would also need to be able to navigate, necessitating a guidance system, and a communication system, and cameras and scientific instruments. The command module was only one element. The vital cylindrical unit below it, the 25-foot-long service module, SM, had its own requirements and challenges, many of them complicated by the delay in selecting the landing mode. As originally conceived, the SM would carry a cluster of solid rocket motors to return Apollo from lunar orbit. Apollo's potential booster rockets, the Saturn family, were in development too. With President Kennedy's address to Congress on May 25, 1961, calling for a manned landing on the moon and safe return to Earth before this decade is out, the modest Apollo effort was suddenly raised to a major national program with a projected $25 billion price tag over 9 years. North American Aviation had won the contract to build Apollo. It took another year for NASA to decide on the mode of landing, lunar orbit rendezvous. The Grumman Corporation was then awarded a contract to build a lunar lander. Within NASA, the effort had been distilled to 3 words: man, moon, decade. Apollo's budget exploded from $1 million in 1961 to $162 million a year later. When George Abbey arrived in Houston in November 1964, Apollo was a $2 billion a year program employing 350,000 people at an estimated 20,000 different companies working on spacecraft, boosters, facilities, and other technology. NASA itself was consuming 2.5% of America's gross national product. In addition to the Command and Service Module, CSM, Lunar Module, and Saturn launchers, Apollo was supported by a number of unmanned programs too. Ranger, out of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL, was designed to beam back photos of the lunar surface as it dove to an eventual crash. 7 Rangers had been launched by the time Abbey reached Houston, with only one, Ranger 7, in July 1964, returning useful imagery. 2 more were to be launched early in 1965. Imagery of the lunar surface from orbit, a more challenging mission, was the goal of Langley's Lunar Orbiter program, one Abbey obviously knew well. The lunar orbiter was scheduled to make its first launch in the summer of 1966. The most ambitious unmanned program was Surveyor, a JPL-led effort to land a vehicle on the lunar surface where close-up photos could be taken and a remote-controlled claw could dig into the lunar regolith to provide information on its consistency. A small but powerful group of scientists had warned for years that the lunar surface was soft dust that would swallow up an Apollo. When he first walked into Building 2, George Abbey was familiar with the broad strokes of the Apollo effort, the year-long battle over lunar orbit rendezvous, for example. He was given a stack of reports and studies and advised to start reading. He also met his new co-workers. There were 36 people in Maynard's office, all white males in their 20s, 30s, and 40s. The only women were secretaries. Abbey officially worked directly for Owen Maynard and his deputy, Bob Williams, who had come to NASA from Thompson Ramo Wooldridge, TRW, where he had worked with Joseph Shea in support of Air Force unmanned missile and satellite programs. Williams would become a good friend. Harry Byington, who specialized in propulsion, and Charles Haynes, who worked on displays, controls, and the human interface with spacecraft systems, were Abbey's office mates. He would quickly grow to like and respect Maynard, though he judged him to be not the most organized person in the world. At first, he was surprised that Maynard expected him to be an expert on configuration management and the means and methods of coordinating and scheduling the development of cutting-edge technology such as ballistic missiles. It turned out that Chet McCullough, another engineer in Maynard's office, had worked with Abbey on the Dinosaur program and knew of Abbey's prior experience in that subject. McCullough had been urging Maynard to get Abbey assigned to Houston. It would take time, but eventually Abbey would judge Maynard's team to be very technically competent and more accomplished than those he had known in the Air Force. In those first weeks, however, he found it difficult to judge the program's status. For example, in September, NASA had performed a review of mock-ups of the Block 2 CSM with North American, yet 2 months later in mid-November, it was still uncertain what had been agreed upon in that review, and if North American was proceeding on an agreed-upon configuration and schedule of work. During his earlier visit, Abbey had been surprised at the lack of oversight of the spacecraft's configuration and of a specification, and he was concerned about the existence of a Block 1 and a Block 2 Apollo command module. The Block 1 spacecraft would only be flown in Earth orbit and would not have the same configuration as the Block 2, which would be flown to the Moon. He brought his concerns to Maynard, who had the ideal solution. After all, this was why he had insisted on having Abbey on his team. "Why don't you take this over? As in, go to North American and Grumman and sort this out." "But I just got here." "That's why you'd be perfect." 8. North American Aviation. "Ready or not, we're coming out." It was the first week in December 1964, and George Abbey and Owen Maynard were on a conference call with James R. Johnson of North American Aviation in California. After exchanging pleasantries with Johnson, Maynard introduced Abbey and said he would be visiting Downey the following week for Johnson's update on the Block 2 CSM. Johnson told Maynard that would be fine, and Abbey made plans to fly to California the following Monday. Founded in 1928, North American was famed for aircraft and missiles, from the T-6 Texan trainer, B-25 bomber, and P-51 Mustang of World War II, to the more recent F-86 and F-100 jet fighters, and the X-15 hypersonic research aircraft. By December 1964, North American had 25,000 employees at work in Southern California, at a facility at Los Angeles Airport.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.